Hey, you want to see a show that'll make you miss that sitcom about Hitler?
Then sit your asses down and let's check out the show that everyone knew was gonna be terrible. And it was. In 2004, the auto insurance company Geico introduced. In 2004, the auto insurance company Geico introduced us to their new marketing characters, the Geico Cavemen. Sort of a send-up of modern political correctness, the joke was that these present-day cavemen exist among us in regular society.
Thus, no longer making them cavemen, I guess.
And they become easily offended at the company's slogan, "It's so easy, a caveman can do it." Which, if cavemen are a normal part of society, then sure, that comes across as an extremely racist thing for a company to not only say, but keep saying over the course of the campaign's several-year run. And you know modern business practices, the second someone complains, they keep doing said offensive thing over and over again. More importantly, if I were a caveman, the slogan itself would upset me because it doesn't even make sense. Cavemen gave us fire and the wheel. Geico gave us a talking gecko. Now, if the slogan were, "It's so easy, EGA could do it," then I would understand. That poor bastard couldn't even survive an Arch Hall Jr. movie.
This is already the stupidest episode I've ever written.
But you know what isn't easy? Television. Thanks to the 2007 series Cavemen, if television were easy, then Geico could do it. But they couldn't. You'd think people would have learned their lesson after the colossal failure of the also based on a commercial Baby Bob series, but I guess a lesson couldn't be learned since no one fucking watched it, therefore are completely unaware of its dismal existence. The entire marketing campaign itself is based on a one-joke premise, so they certainly have their work cut out for them in making a television series. Turns out the show was not only an unfunny one-joke premise, but also somewhat offensive, and it was canceled after airing only 6 episodes. It later turned up on the Chicago Tribune's list of the 25 worst TV shows of all time, and TV Guide's list of the biggest blunders in television history. The New York Post declared the show extinct on arrival, and there's some truth to that.
Let's be honest, very few actually went into this show with an open mind. Upon even hearing the news that a series was going to be made out of the Geico Cavemen, this thing was written off as trash before even one word was written into the script.
You can argue whether that's fair or unfair to the show or its creator Joe Lawson, who later went on to the much more highly acclaimed series Modern Family. But regardless of any preset bias that people had going into the show, it's still not very good. The bad luck all started with the series' unaired pilot, shot in 2007, which, after a disastrous test screening, did not see the light of day until a 2008 release on Australian television. But like other great shows, at least it gives us a little backstory in the opening, in case we have any questions.
Since the dawn of existence, only one noble race of human beings has withstood the test of time. Though many thought this unique breed of man was lost in the bitter winds of the Ice Age, here they are among us on the streets and sidewalks of modern life. These proud men and women may not look like you, but they're just like you. This is the story of three of them.
Couple things.
Much like the commercials, they no longer live in caves, so really, it's just a show about guys with long hair and beards, which I guess is a fucking thing now. And why would we be completely unaware of their existence? One apparently ran for president. It looks like this one was an astronaut. It seems everyone should know that they're among us. But right off the bat, the tone for the entire series is established.
A market on Dominion Avenue becomes the latest in a recent spree of late-night robberies. The robbery was caught by this in-store security camera.
Great. Why do you have to be a caveman?
Of course it's a caveman. They only put it on TV when it's a caveman.
The cavemen are minorities, except they're white.
And they have an extra bone in their head.
Charge, the police have released this sketch. Police are asking anybody...
I mean, look at that. Is that supposed to be one of us? Oh. That thing looks like a hairy baby raisin.
Believe me, I get the commentary, and I understand that they're trying to be clever, But there's not really a joke there, beyond him being called a raisin and being made up to look like a monkey. Buy our insurance! But they aren't completely unrelatable.
Don't put the empty waffle box back in the freezer, alright? It gives me the impression that we've actually got waffles.
All right.
I could totally sympathize. Sometimes I crave the cheeseburger Hot Pockets, but somebody puts the empty box back in the freezer, thus crushing my buttery cheese and meat stuffed heart, Dave! Oh, and when one of them is a sellout, they are portrayed as stereotypically white.
I took this great shot across the street from my house just to show you spring is in the air, which is really weird because it's summer, real hot.
Are you kidding me with this guy? Look at him. This guy's a joke.
Yeah, take that, Al Roker. Right? I'm sorry, this is bugging me. How oppressed can they be when one ran for president in the 1940s? And what does this even mean? If we're going by history here, did the caveman win the presidency? And is this implying that Truman is part caveman? And with its continued race bait comparisons, it has the subtlety of a Nick Swarsden stereotype. Oh, God damn it, of course.
I need a time out. A hard one. Half hour, 40?
You may think this show is slightly cutting edge because it doesn't have a laugh track, but I'm willing to bet that it does. It's just that unfunny.
Actually, you see those people behind you?
Yeah.
Those are customers. Do I have to talk to them?
Go.
What do I say?
Go ahead.
Help. I don't know what's that.
There goes Swarsden, thus robbing us of all the Bucky Larson magic that could have been brought to the show. As for our leads, there's Joel, whose plot revolves around being in a relationship with a white girl, and in a surprising bit of casting, stand-up comedian Nick Kroll plays Nick, the slacker-style, militant, ultra-PC caveman who foes outrage at the drop of a hat. There's also Jamie, who was replaced in subsequent episodes by Superman Returns Sam Huntington and renamed Andy. Joel wants dearly to get Kate's blessing from her father so that they can get married, but think less guess who's coming to dinner and more guess who.
Without his blessing, I just feel like he's not accepting me, you know, especially after what happened.
Baby, that really wasn't that big of a deal.
I hit him in the head with a golf club.
Okay, well, why'd you hit him in the head with a golf club?
He was surprised more than anything else, really.
I just hate that it played right into the stereotype.
Ha 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 ha, yeah, it's like clubbing him in the head, because he's a caveman. Okay, why did this happen?
Have I ever told you that I've always had a thing for cowboys?
Okay, never mind. I guess more important shit to tend to. This guy looks like Hank Williams Jr. right after the accident. But you gotta hand it to Nick Kroll. He is a genuinely funny stand-up who really tries his damnedest in a show where he really didn't have to. But I'm glad he did.
You know what this reminds me of? The time I saw Boys Don't Cry with my mom. That's how uncomfortable I feel right now.
And that would be funnier than what I've seen so far, because some of these analogies are starting to make less and less sense.
You don't even know these people.
No, I do know these people. They've been oppressing our people for 750,000 years.
Really? That long ago? How were you being oppressed in a time period when there was nothing but cavemen? Another amazing fact, the show went 8 whole minutes before making its first Flintstones reference.
And you watch TV, it's all politically correct, but they air the Flintstones 6 times a day. I mean, it's just freaking hypocritical. Yabba-dabba-doo! Seriously, don't do that.
At least a laugh track thought that the Flintstones was funny. That show was animated. Why the hell did that have a laugh track?
I hate to break it to you, Jamie, but, we're cavemen!
Again, no you're not. You live in an apartment. That's like saying that everyone in the human race is 5 years old. Yeah, we were 5. Once. Seriously, they just look like 70s porn stars. I'm waiting for them to reenact forced entry, not spew out cavemen jokes. The cavemen are invited to a function at Kate's father's country club, and in case you forgot they're supposed to represent minorities, they'll remind you, again.
Well, I was gonna wear this regardless.
Yeah, I always wondered what Reba McEntire would look like if she was a Cro-Magger.
Please don't use that word.
Because it's kind of reminiscent of that one word. Oh, what is it? Ninjas. Oh, wait, no. That's not the one. And why is Nick in on this joke? He's the one who's been so uber PC about cavemen relations this entire episode. By the way, it's a predominantly white country club, so...
Could you please check the list again?
Last name?
Again, it's Claybrook.
I got no pass for Claybrook.
I'll try Kate again.
What a shocker, no pass for the Magger.
Maggers? I'm watching a car full of white guys complaining about racial slurs that they're calling themselves. That's not even stupid white people problems. That's just bad writing. And Maggers? That sounds like a pet name someone would give their grandma. Oh, but what about its ultra-hip soundtrack?
Hey, take my hand and come with me because you look so fine that I really want to make you mine.
Not only is Jet offended to be in this series, but so is the riff from Lust for Life. But that's not all. Look, they snuck in by driving around the place in a golf cart, because I guess that'll work. The song isn't for them. They're just playing it because Uncle Buck showed up.
I think you're a genius. This must just drive your dad completely insane.
Yeah, but not because of the whole race thing, but because you're in the show Cavemen.
What's the sex like? Is it true what everyone says?
Well, of course they got big dicks, but not because they're supposed to be black, but because I'm still convinced that they're John Holmes, Ron Jeremy, and Harry Reams.
Thanks for dressing up, Nick.
Thanks for inviting us, Kate.
He did dress up. Don't you see the stupid makeup he's wearing? And holy shit, John Hurd was in something even deadlier than the Sharknado.
I told you he just has a weird way of showing affection. When I won a spelling bee in fourth grade, he gave me a box of steaks for crying out loud.
Yeah, but that was in his Cutter and Bone days. He was a bit more intense back then. And since this is the South and there's old people here, something racist is gonna happen.
Nick, this is Mrs. Winston. She is actually the President General of United Daughters of the Confederacy.
I'm sorry, is this implying that the Civil War was fought over cavemen? In fact, do black people even exist in this universe? Because if not, all this proves is that we as a society need to be so racist about something that simply guys with a lot of hair will do. Or is it because they're the most slapsticky of the bunch?
Just a little... Oh, I am so sorry. But notice she's fine. She's fine. You're fine, right?
Why is that guy so pissed? It was clearly an accident. And it's sad that one of the few ways that I know that there are other races in this universe is because of this line.
Where did you learn how to dance like that?
Soul Train.
You watch Soul Train?
Once again, Don Cornelius answering all of life's little questions, even if said question is about the Cavemen series. The rest of the show is just shenanigans at the country club, a lot of it being extremely random.
They seem to be getting along pretty well, right?
I'm cheating on your father.
And by the way, I definitely have breast cancer. Nick tries to teach Joel to be more manly and assertive, so Nick challenges the snooty club members to a game of horseshoes.
We're playing for $20 a game, son.
Oh, isn't that cute? I'd say we should play for a hundy, but I don't want you girls to wet your panties.
Ooh. I really love how Krall is both too good for this show and clearly knows it. Yeah, it's because he's making you laugh. Otherwise, you'd hate his guts. Krall is the only one who escapes this with his dignity still intact, which is a bit more than I can say about the Dude Meister from Scrubs.
Going? Where were you on Saturday? Well, you don't like Dave Matthews anymore?
Someone in Cavemen can't judge someone else for their taste. Joel finally gets his chance to talk to Kate's dad in the bathroom. There's so much class in this scene, I'm waiting for him to call him the Godfucker.
Nope. Let me tell you something, son. No daughter of mine is ever going to wash her clothes with a rock.
What?
They haven't lived in caves in tens of thousands of years. That's like if he were afraid that you were going to throw him into a den of lions. Damn it, John Hurd, you were in After Hours. The casting here is just weird. Hell, in a later episode, Progressive Flow turns up.
We honor over 24 midwinter holidays. New Year's, Dongji, Makara Sankrati, the Incas, Inter Raymi, not including the human sacrifice, of course.
Fuck making a series about Flow. Make one about this guy.
One hot and ready pizza, $5.
Andy, meanwhile, becomes a little obsessed with being a cowboy, which I guess will happen when you succumb to the power of line dance montage.
Look, what do you think? Garth Brooks.
Clint Eastwood.
Brooks or Eastwood?
You look more like Marty McFly's Clint Eastwood. But somehow this costume works for him.
Oh, wait a minute.
What?
Told you I was wild.
The cavemen just fucked a girl in a dressing room and then puked on her tits. Why wasn't a Geico commercial made out of that? But when Nick owes the old gents some horseshoe money, race comes up again.
$300 is $300, and I do not care if you are Asian, Malaysian, Pan-Asian, or French-Canadian. I want my money.
Notice he didn't say caveman.
Okay.
Probably because calling someone a magger is stupid, even when this happens.
What are you doing?
Just like the time I fell into a box of clovers while a keg of Guinness dumped on my face, and then for some reason I started chanting for the Celtics.
Well, thank you, Joel. That was fun, wasn't it? But now, everybody, Fernando's made a big old bunch of cosmos. Come on.
I've heard of patronizing the audience, even patronizing other characters. But it's extremely rare that I see a character just straight up patronize the script. So everything works out. Joel gains her father's acceptance, and they can all live as equal.
Unfortunately, it seems someone has stolen the tip jar from the bartenders. If anyone has any information regarding this incident, please see me or any of the other board members.
That is until something bad happens and everyone instantly blames the cavemen.
Are they looking at us? I think they're looking at us. Where's the car?
Ha, white people, right? Like us. As you may have figured, no amount of tampering saved this show. When the pilot was reshot, the setting was changed from Atlanta, Georgia to San Diego. Yeah, cause that was the show's problem.
It's a good rule, Joel. Keep your penis in your genus.
I certainly get the satire, and it's obvious they really wanted this show to be somewhat thought-provoking and socially relevant, when it very easily could have been just a 30-minute sewer of Chuck Lorre laugh track dick and fart jokes. But there's a reason this really only worked as a 30-second advertisement. You can't make an entire series based on the sole premise of cavemen being an oppressed minority, which they really weren't. But anyway, after 5 minutes, the joke becomes incredibly stale, incredibly fast. Much like how Heil Honey, I'm Home's premise maybe could have worked as a 5-minute sketch equating Nazism with sitcom cliches, but it gets boring when that's the only thing driving its humor for 30 minutes.
Stick to your kind, crave the cave.
Hell, I can't imagine how offended the Slag Brothers must be with this ruining the good name of cavemen comedy, which had a hard enough time surviving caveman. The series became a source of some of Nick Kroll's stand-up material and was even referenced in a subsequent cavemen TV ad, but it quietly fell into such obscurity that its characters don't even pop up on a Wikipedia list for cavemen characters, which even includes unfrozen caveman lawyer. And now I must sit here as I patiently await a new series where the talking M&Ms share an apartment with Charlie the Tuna and Crinkles the Clown. I don't mean to spoil it for you, but in the pilot, someone does get molested.
Boom! Dose! Drink!